Thank you. morning, church family.
Good morning.
This is Catherine Long, and Dr. Long comes today to rededicate her life to Jesus Christ through baptism. She told me that she reconnected with the Lord through her medical practice and seeing God work in amazing ways through medicine. Isn't that cool? That's wonderful. So, Dr. Long, let me ask. Yeah, you can clap. Let's clap. Let me ask you. Do you confess with your mouth that Jesus is your Lord?
Yes.
And do you believe with all your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead?
Yes.
Then Catherine Long, my sister in Christ, because of your profession of faith and your obedience to Christ in baptism, I baptize you in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, buried with Christ in baptism. Church. Our Father God, we thank you so much for Dr. Long and her profession of you, Jesus, that you are risen, you're out of the grave, your grave is empty. God, as we come to you in worship today, we thank you for the way that you transform our lives. We pray that you would be with Catherine, that you would encourage her, that you would help her to find the places where you're calling her to use her gifts and abilities. And God, we thank you for the salvation that we have through Jesus Christ, your Son. It's in his name we pray.
Amen.
Well, church, welcome. We're glad that you're here today. If you're visiting with us, thanks for being here and being a part of our worship today. There is a blue connection information card in your worship bulletin there. We'd love for you to fill that out and let us know who you are. We have offering plates at our exits. You can place that connection card there as well. If you have something in your life that you'd like our church family to be praying for you about, we would love to for you to write that on the blue card and drop it in the offering plate, and we will be praying for you this week. Welcome to worship. Would you stand together as we sing?
Church, who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. King above all kings, yeah. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy.
What would we do without God's grace? What would we do without His pardon for us? This morning, I have a word for you, but it's not from me. It's from God's word. And it's from Psalm 66, starting in verse 16. Come and listen, all you who fear God, and I will tell you what He did for me. For I cried out to Him for help, praising Him as I spoke. If I had not confessed the sin in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. But God did listen. He paid attention to my prayer. Praise God, who did not ignore my prayer or withdraw His unfailing love for me. I don't know if maybe you're holding on to something. Maybe there's something you haven't confessed to God. But what I love about this passage here is it said, if I hadn't done this, He wouldn't have heard me. But He did. He did hear me. He listened to my prayer. And sometimes we don't take our concerns to God and we just hold on to them. Or sometimes we're holding on to a sin and we don't let go of it and we don't confess it to God. But if you do, it says here that He will pay attention to your prayer and He will not withdraw His unfailing love for you and for me. And so today, let's spend some time. Let's bow our heads, close our eyes, and spend time with God right now individually. And confess to Him if there's something or something you're holding on to you need to let go of. Give that to God right now.
Thank you, Nick. That was awesome. Now is our time for our offering that we can give up to the Lord. There's four ways that you can provide your offering to the church for God to use. You can mail it to the church. You can set up a direct deposit from your bank, or go to our website and do a offering that way. Or lastly, if you're here in the church, there are plates at both of our entrances that you can leave it there. So let's bow our heads in prayer. Lord God Jesus, you're an amazing God. How you provide for all of our needs, how you watch over us and guide us and shape us into what you would have us be. I ask you, Lord, right now that you will take up these offerings, use them with this church to grow and nurture and strengthen your kingdom here on earth, Father God, that your will would be done and many more would come to your saving grace. So, Father God, be with us right now. Give it up for us so that we could be using it for you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yeah.
blessing it is to worship with you today. Now we'll hear the reading from God's Word. Pastor Reed's going to come on up. And kids, this morning we're going to dismiss the kids to Children's Church. So ages 3 to 9. So if you'll go to the back, Becky Gerwin's back there. She's waving. And you're dismissed to Children's Church.
Good morning, church family. It is Pi Day. Pi, the mathematical constant. It's 3.14 and on and on. Some people also call it Pi Day because they like to eat P-I-E on Pi Day. It's Time Change Sunday. We're just piling them on here. We had a baptism today. We have a guest speaker today. We have updates to our COVID policies and procedures today. All kinds of things. If some of you maybe didn't get to see it at the very beginning of the service, I hope you were able to see Dr. Catherine Long rededicate her life to the Lord through baptism. And her testimony is so cool. She said that she reconnected to God after many, many years away through her medical practice. You know, so often we hear that science and faith are opposed. And she said, I found the Lord again as I saw him work miraculously in my medical practice. She was a surgeon down in El Paso. It's beautiful. Our COVID updates. Our capacity was moved from a third, 33%, to 50% this week. Just want to let you know and kind of update you. We haven't talked about this in a long time, that basically all of our policies are the same. We will move up and down with those capacities and allow you and your family to decide when it's right for you to come to church in person. We'll keep doing our television broadcasts and our web broadcasts so that it gives you those options and you can make that choice. We will, just like we've been doing, keep wearing our masks or face shields to offer grace and love to those around us. Kids, we say just do your best with your kiddos. Some kids love masks. They think it's the coolest thing. Other kids would rather wear their mask on their ears than over their nose and mouth. And they're kids. That's fine. We do the best with kids. We do have kids worship. If you don't know, every Sunday except for the third Sunday of the month. So during the sermon time, the kids can go down in the CLC and have fun activities. And then on the third Sundays of every month, we have pastor's pals down on the steps here with me. And we also have worship bags to help your kids make it through the sermon time. And we believe that it's really a partnership between parents and the church to teach our next generation how to worship. And so we want them in here sometimes. And we often do communion, although this month we won't, on those third Sundays. And so we want those kids seeing us do communion and asking you, hey, what's that? What's that bread and juice and cracker about? So most things are the same. We have changed a couple of things. We're going to be, as you can tell, we're getting more full in here, and we'll be removing the blue tape and these crumpled up white signs reserving pews. And from now on, when you come in, it will be open seating, and you just do your best to space out and to give others space to the best that you can. We're going to need the room as we have more capacity. And finally, one more change, and this is the one that I'm most excited about. For Easter, we are asking you to invite your friends, and so that day we are going to have two worship services on Easter Sunday. Really excited about that. We'll have one at 9 a.m. and one at 11 a.m. It's been feeling full in here, even as it is this morning, and we realize that we all are a little more sensitive to crowds these days. Have you noticed that? You notice the people around you a little bit more. And so we are going to have two worship services that day. Our worship team and our deacon body and pastoral leadership team all unanimously said we've got to do that on Easter. And so we're excited about that. We are asking our leaders, our volunteers, who don't mind signing up to go to the 9 a.m. service. After worship today, we will have a sign-up sheet. And for the Sundays leading up to Easter, if you don't mind signing up to go to that first service, that will allow the second service to have as much room as possible for those who are bringing guests. If you're bringing a guest, you can bring them to either service, but we want to make sure in that 11 o'clock service to have plenty of room. And then we're going to have some fun activities in between, so if you still want to come to church at 10:30 or stay a little bit late, if you go to the early service, we're going to have some fun activities. If the weather's nice out on our portal, we're really excited about that. You know, God is good, And he is doing good things amongst you because of your work and your witness. And I'm really excited for us to have that chance to offer two worship services to our community. We're going to read God's word from John chapter 1. If you want to open your Bibles there or find it on your phone, John 1, we're going to read verses 43 to 51. Today, I'd like us to stand in honor and respect of God's word. Would you stand together? John 1, 43 to 51. The next day, he proposed to go into Galilee, and he found Philip and Jesus. And Jesus said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, on the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." Nathanael said to him, "Can any good thing come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." Jesus saw Nathanael coming to him and said of him, "Behold, an Israelite indeed in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael said to him, "How do you know me?" Jesus answered and said to him, "Before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you." Nathanael answered him, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered and said to him, "Because I said to you that I saw you under the fig tree, do you believe? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, you will see the heavens opened and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man." This is God's word. You may be seated. One of my favorite things about being a Baptist is partnering together to reach people for Jesus.
Amen.
You may know all Baptist churches are independent, but we freely associate and partner in order to reach the world for Jesus Christ. We believe we can do more together. We're better together than we are by ourselves. We're the only evangelical Christian denomination whose missionaries do not have to raise money for their mission work. Many of my missionary friends with other denominations spend, they tell me, 50% of their time or more just raising money instead of being missionaries and in telling people about Jesus. So every dollar that any of us give, at least 10% of that goes to missions. And for our offerings, like the Annie Armstrong Easter offering for North American missions that we're taking up right now, our state missions offering, the Lottie Moon Christmas offering for international missions, 100% of those dollars goes right to the field to missionaries to help them do their disaster relief work, church planting here in New Mexico, telling people about Jesus in Africa and literally all over the world. And we have here in New Mexico a new lead missionary. It's my delight to introduce our speaker this morning. He is the new executive director of the Baptist Convention of New Mexico, Reverend Steve Ballou. Steve is a friend. He is a humble and funny leader, although I don't know if he'll be humorous today or not. I can't tell you that. But he is also committed to Jesus and his word, and that's what I love about him. I'm excited that he's going to be bringing leadership to our convention in the coming days and our work here in New Mexico. Prior to coming to the BCNM, Steve pastored four churches over 32 years, including most recently Emmanuel Baptist Church in Farmington, New Mexico for almost 10 years. We've got some members here today. And in fact, Catherine Long has a connection to that church, which is really cool. We didn't realize God was going to be making that connection today. Steve graduated from Clovis High School here in New Mexico, has a Bachelor's of Accounting from New Mexico State, and the Master's of Divinity from Southwestern Baptist Theological Seminary. He was the president of the Arizona Baptist Convention, chairman of their executive board, and just finished a stint as chairman of our executive board. That's where I met him. He's married to Cheryl. They have four adopted children, something very near and dear to our church family's heart. You guys were excited about that. They have 12 grandchildren. Let's pray for Steve, and then he's going to come and lead us. Father God, we thank you that you have brought our friends from the BCNM here to help lead us today. We ask that you would speak through Steve. Father, may the words of his mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer.
Well, thank you. I'm so glad to be here this morning, so glad to be able to share with you. Thank you for the opportunity to do so. I also want to thank you for sharing Reed and Amy with the rest of the state. You probably know, but Reed serves on our state mission board. As a matter of fact, Reed was the one who recommended me to this position, so I blame him. It's all his fault. And you know, you share Amy with our New Mexico Baptist Children's Home Board, and she does a marvelous job there serving in that capacity. You mentioned the connection. It's really interesting. Catherine's been in our church in Emmanuel several times because her daughter and her husband are members of our church there. And I actually got to baptize her daughter and her grandson while I was there. And so it's kind of a cool thing that we can connect that way today and just watch Catherine be baptized also. So it's been a good day so far. What does a lead missionary do? And the truth is, I started January 1, so I don't know. I have no clue what my job is yet. I'm still trying to learn all the pieces and where all the cogs are and how they fit together and all those kinds of things. But basically, we try to give leadership to trying to forward the gospel in the state of New Mexico, and as well as connecting with our partners, Southern Baptist partners around the world, to try and do the same thing. I want to thank you. Your church is a giving church to all those efforts. You actually, First Baptist Santa Fe, is in the top 35 of the cooperating churches in New Mexico in giving the cooperative program. We appreciate that. That means every time you give an offering, a portion of that ends up in missions. Every single time you give to support missionaries. And when you give to Mission New Mexico, which you'll probably do mostly in the fall of the year, your church was number 12 last year, by the way, in Mission New Mexico, across New Mexico. We appreciate that. What does that do for us? Let me share with you that during 2020, we had 10 church plants that you supported through those mechanisms. You did that. And three of those graduated in 2020 to become self-supporting, self-propagating. We don't need your help anymore, churches. We've added 7 more since then, and we continue. I signed off paperwork for another church this last week that you will fund through your cooperative program, Mission New Mexico Giving. You're doing that. You don't even know, but you're doing that. I'm going to share with you. 2020 was a hard year, amen? So many ways. But one of the ways was in hunger ministries. Through your cooperative program giving, through Mission New Mexico, you partnered with hunger ministries throughout the state of New Mexico. Let me tell you what that did. You fed over 200,000 people throughout 2020. You did that through your giving. That's amazing. You also trained 511 volunteers how to share their faith as they gave out that food. And while they gave out food, they led 328 people to make professions of faith in 2020. 62 of which have already been baptized. That's amazing. You support through your cooperative program giving collegiate ministries. What do I mean by that? Well, there are eight campuses that we have collegiate ministers on, and they're funded. They stay predominant. We pay their salary through the cooperative program, and we fund them in other ways through Mission New Mexico and through other budgetary means. But you keep them on the field. Here's what happens. They lead students to Christ. I read this last week. I got 2 emails this last week from the campus leader at New Mexico State University. They train the students, the campus leaders train the students to go out on campus 2 by 2. They find people just kind of sitting around, waiting around, doing whatever. 2 of those teams this week led 2 different people to faith in Christ. That's not possible if you don't give to your local church, and your local church in turn gives to the cooperative program, and you also give to Mission New Mexico on top of that. Let me give you one more, because this one kind of blows my mind also. In 2020, our state mission board, which I said Pastor Reed's a part of, we voted to redistribute Mission New Mexico funds, because there were some things, because of the pandemic, we couldn't do some ministries. So we said, well, if we can't do those things, let's use that money to do something we think is important. So we reassigned those dollars, the board did, to help churches keep their doors open during the pandemic. Now your church did quite well. You financially support. There are other churches that just, they struggled tremendously. Literally, here's what happened. Literally, we used those funds to keep 29 churches open by paying electric bills, insurance bills, those kinds. They would not be open today if you hadn't given to Mission New Mexico in the past. Beyond that, you've helped 18 pastors' families provide for their needs because their churches couldn't pay them. The first week of January, I was talking to a pastor on the phone. I said, How can I help you? He said, well, actually, the truth is the church hasn't been able to pay me for over 6 months, and my wife's job can't cover everything, and we just need groceries. He said, we're out of food. I have two teenage boys. We don't have any food. I said, we will get you some food. You paid for their groceries. You did that. God did that through you. Thank you for doing that. It's important. Let me give you one more thing that's important. What's important is the Annie Armstrong Easter offering. You're going to see a video a little bit later. What the Annie Armstrong Easter offering is not icing on the cake for the North American Mission Board. That's not the way that works. It's a part of the cake. So when you give to the Annie Armstrong Easter offering, you actually keep church planters on the field, several of whom are in New Mexico. You'll see a video later today. I think the one today is for a missionary up in Farmington that you help keep on the field because you give. Thank you so much for doing that. Let me dive in a different direction. Have you ever met a celebrity? Somebody that just, you know, they had some kind of, you knew them, they didn't know you, but you knew them because they were famous in some form or fashion. It used to be when you met a celebrity, here's what you would do, right? You would meet that celebrity and you would, you'd walk up to them and you'd try to ask them if you could take a picture with them, and you have to hand somebody your camera, and they would stand across the street to get a nice picture of you and that celebrity hanging out together, right? Or you got a glossy 8x10 that was signed or something. You did that. I can remember when I was in high school, I went to a program that sent me to Washington, D.C. to meet with congressional representatives there. You might not think that's great, but I came home with my 8.5x11 glossy of Senator Pete Domenici. Hey, I thought that was pretty awesome. Some of you have no idea who Pete Domenici is. I feel so sorry for you. You have no idea who I'm talking about. That's terrible, 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 terrible. But here's what we do now, right? If you meet somebody famous now, you pull out your phone and you stand there with them and you kind of get in the frame, right? And you kind of like this, right? Tick, tick, and the picture literally is just right up their nose, right? I mean, that's how we do that now. We meet celebrities. Our story that Reed read about a little bit earlier. A man meets a budding celebrity. He's not a celebrity yet. He's not well known yet, but he will be worldwide known soon as this gospel unfolds, right? There's a problem here. There's no film technology. So he can't prove he's met the guy. He can't show somebody, here's a picture of the guy I just met. Look, here's his autograph. I mean, none of that happened. He didn't even ask for an autograph. But we do know what he did go and do, and he went and found a friend who could tell him that he met this guy about his discovery, right? So we just looked at the story, just read the passage. I want to share you two or three things this morning about this passage out of John chapter 1 that just strike me as important. And number one, I want to start with is this. It's a personal conviction. I have a personal conviction about you as a follower of Jesus Christ. What does that mean? Well, I have this. I believe this. I believe that all true followers of Christ, all true followers of Christ want to invite others to know Jesus. I think everybody who has a relationship with Christ wants to share with those others who don't yet have that relationship. That's it. Now, I got to tell you, that conviction runs counter to a lot of statistics I read. A lot of statistics I read say that most, like about 80% of people who claim to have a relationship with Christ never share their faith about Christ with somebody else. That's remarkable. That's a mind-blowing in some way. But I think the question, yeah, who's right? Are those folks that do the statistics right, or am I right? I think both of us are right. We just need to figure out why we're not doing what we really want to do. And there are more than a couple of reasons. Let me give you a couple. One is, some of you are raised in a generation that you didn't talk about two things in public. Remember what they are? You didn't talk about politics and religion. Well, we got over the politics part. We talk about that a lot, right? Why haven't we got over the other? Well, we talk about Jesus a lot. Or at least as much as we talk about the politicians we like or don't like. Many of us have a complete misunderstanding about sharing our faith. We think that I don't know all the answers to all the questions somebody should ask, so I don't open the conversation. I'm afraid I'm going to be asked a question I can't answer, so I don't even have the conversation that makes this entire thing possible. Can I share with you something? The person you share your faith with does not expect you to have all the answers, because I know they don't have all the answers. It's okay to struggle together a little bit about what are the answers to this thing called faith. The reason I have this conviction is because when you give your life to Christ, the Holy Spirit, God and the person of the Holy Spirit, comes to live inside of you. Amen? And the job, the responsibility of the Spirit of God, that part of the Trinity, is to witness about Jesus. That's what he does. He does that. That's what his thing is. God makes you his home. Now, I want you to track with me for just a second. When God gives you the Holy Spirit, when God gives you himself, he makes you his house, his place of living. In Ephesians, Paul calls this a down payment or an escrow payment. Have you ever bought a piece of property? Yeah, it's not a trick question, I promise, okay? I promise not to fake you out on any question I ask. All right? Well, when you want to buy a piece of property, what do? In order to prove that you are earnest about it, that you really intend to follow through on the purchase, what do? Well, you have to put down a little bit of cash to say, I'm really going to follow through on this purchase. I'm going to get the loan. I'm going to get the rest of the money, whatever you have to do with it. But here's my earnest payment. I really am earnest about this, right? Hello. And then, see, somebody's calling to make a sale right now. It's so awesome. And so what happens, though, when you pull out on that agreement? What happens if you change your mind? You decide, you know what, never mind. Either you can't pull together the money. You decide you don't want the property. Do you get that money back that you put down? No. You lose it. It's gone. Forever and ever and ever to you. Well, think about this. God gave you himself. God gave you himself as his earnest payment on your eternal inheritance. Think about it. So if God pulls out on the deal, he loses himself. That's not going to happen. Once you give your life to Christ, he gives you himself forever. You are part, you are related in that sense forever. And the job of the Holy Spirit, I said earlier, is to glorify the Son. His role is to bring other people into relationship with the Son. Now let me ask you, where does he live again right now? He lives inside of us, right? Lives in us. So here we are back at the beginning. All true followers of Jesus Christ, because they are inhabited by God himself, have a desire to share the God who's inhabited them with other people yet. Now, Philip has met Jesus. Now, it's before the giving of the Holy Spirit, but listen to this. He didn't know much of anything. He just met him earlier that day. But he knew enough to say three simple words. I want you to say them with me, all right? Come and see. That's it. Come and see. He didn't argue with Nathanael. He didn't have a debate with Nathanael. He just offered an invitation. That's our job. It's not to debate people in the kingdom. It's not to argue people in the kingdom. It's just to invite them to come and see, come and learn what I've learned. Because if we know if they'll come and see, what will they do? Eventually, having come and seen, they will stay. Because Jesus makes that big a difference. Amen? Many of us, I think, miss the most important aspect of sharing our faith. Let me give it to you. What's the most important thing about sharing your faith may not actually be the verbal communication, but it's in the pre-evangelism stage. It's the getting ready to share your faith. What do you do to get ready to share your faith? The pre-evangelism. Well, number one is pray for people by name. I appreciate inside your worship folder this morning, on the bottom half of that yellow card, is a list you can make about people to pray for to come to know Christ. You know, you talk to Jesus about people before you talk to people about Jesus. And that's a very important aspect of this, right? You develop friendships and relationships with people, pray with the people that you're praying for. Here's the deal. And you make a commitment, all right, that you will pray for and make relationships with people whether or not they ever come to faith in Christ. They are not your project. They are relationships that you're making that hopefully have eternal, you're making an eternal difference in. You relate to them. And you start having conversations about everyday life. Do you know most people like to talk? I don't know if you've noticed that or not. Most people like, so here's the skill you need to learn that I'm trying to learn. The skill we need to all learn is this. Shut up and listen, right? People like to talk. They like to kind of verbalize and get stuff out there. And we will learn a whole lot more if we'll stop thinking about what we want to say and just listen and ask questions and probe and just pull things out of folks. And again, remember, they're not a project. They are worth defending just because. How important are those things? Well, let me ask you a very important question. Who's the Philip in your life? Who's the person who said to you, come and see? Maybe it was your parent, your mom or your dad. Maybe it was a spouse, a boyfriend or a girlfriend. Maybe it was a grandparent. Maybe it was a friend, a coworker. I don't know. But for everyone in this room and everyone watching, I'm going to guess there's at least one Philip. There's somebody who was significant in your life who shared with you simply to say, just come and check this out. This is life transforming. For me, as a guy named David, David was my suite mate at New Mexico State and at alumni dorm. And so at alumni dorm in New Mexico State, there were two guys in one room, and then there was a bathroom, and then there was another two guys in another room. So four guys shared one bathroom. Can you imagine what that looked like after a few weeks? But nonetheless, all right. But this guy, he moved in the second semester. It wasn't their first semester. Second semester, my freshman year, he moves in. And I became his Nathaniel. I didn't know he was my Philip until much later. But I became his Nathaniel. And he began to share with me daily, having conversations with me daily about who this Jesus was, whom I knew a little bit about, but I didn't know a lot about. And finally, after about a month, I reached the point that Nathaniel did, that this is worth giving my life to. Who's your Philip? And then who are you going to be Philip to? Here's the second. Let's talk about sharing the good news. You read this story, right? Do you have friends who are skeptics? Family members who are a little skeptical about all this stuff? Yeah, here's Nathaniel. What Philip did. Philip was from, or Nathaniel. Nathaniel's from Cana. Cana's about 4 miles from Nazareth, give or take. It's about 4 miles. When Philip announced, we have found the one Moses wrote about, I wish there was film of this. Don't you wish sometimes somebody had a video camera back in those days, they could film this stuff? I think between the white lines, when Nathaniel says, can anything good come out of Nazareth? He is rolling on the ground laughing. Like, really? You got to be kidding me. Nazareth? Now, there's a lot of reasons why this may have happened, but one primary reason was it appears that Cana and Nazareth are a little bit of rivals. A little bit of rivals. Do you remember having rivalries in high school? Your high school rival? Maybe that's kind of what's going on here a little bit. I remember for me, I graduated Clovis High School, as Reed said. Our primary rival was Hobbs High School. I remember going to Hobbs one time for a football game. I didn't play, praise God. I didn't have the physique for that. And to this day, I thank Jesus. I didn't suffer a lot of pain that way. But I went on the activity bus. On the way out of town, they are pelting our bus with rocks and trash. I mean, it was a rivalry, you know. They hated us, and we didn't much like them. In fact, I haven't been to Hobbs since. I don't want to go to Hobbs. Several good Baptist churches down there. Eventually, I'm going to have to make it there. But it's like last on my list, you know, going to Hobbs. Can anything good come out of Hobbs? I mean, that's kind of my question, you know. No, it's impossible. Can't happen. That's Nathaniel. Does anything good come out of Nazareth? You got to be kidding me, right? But I also want you to follow in the story. I think they're having a continuing conversation. I don't think this is the first time, if you can read between the lines a little bit, I don't think this is the first time they're having this conversation about the possibility of the Messiah, Philip and Nathaniel. Because I don't think he just started off with, we found the one who Moses wrote about. I think they've been talking about this before. And so this conversation has finally unfolded to the point where Philip can say, I found him. I've discovered him. He's coming our way right now. Wow. You don't share things you don't know. That means a couple things. You don't get stressed out about sharing things you don't know about Jesus. You simply share about what you do know about Jesus. If you have a relationship with Jesus Christ, you know enough to share Jesus. Can I encourage you with that? Here's what you share. You share my life before I came to Jesus, how I came to Jesus, and what he's doing in my life right now. That may take all of 3 minutes to share, but you know what? That may be life transformational for the person you're sharing it with, because they never heard that before. They've never heard that God isn't just something there, out there somewhere in the great by and by, or some being who doesn't really care about what's going on here, who may or may not exist. Suddenly they meet somebody who has a personal, walking, vibrant relationship, and that they're going, wow, how can this be, right? That's what you share. And then you make the commitment to learn more. As a pastor, I've learned a lot of different ways to share the gospel, and I've trained a lot of folks in a lot of those different ways to share the gospel. My favorite of all time is a thing called Faith Sunday School Evangelism. And Faith Sunday School Evangelism, as it sounds, kind of tied sharing your faith with Sunday school and marry the two back together again like they're supposed to be. So here's how it works. It was a 13-week program. All right, so you went to church for 13, you went to visitation 13 weeks, you went for an hour training, you go out and share for an hour, you come back and share how things went. But when I went to the training was condensed. I took 13 weeks of training, condensed into 2.5 days, and you're supposed to go out and do it, and you go out and do it, and you go home, and you start the whole thing in your church that week. You just go do it. So we did. A couple of weeks later, we come home, and we start sharing this. Now, the very first time out, I've got my team, very first night out, I've got two folks from my church with me, one man, one woman, and we're going to make this visit to this man, and he doesn't know Christ. Perfect, right? Ding, ding, ding. Great opportunity. Well, I'm the pastor. I'm supposed to model all this, right? I'm supposed to be the expert. So I begin to share, you know, in your personal opinion, what do you think it takes for a person to get to heaven and have eternal life? He gives me a really solid works answer. I said, wait, would you like to know how the Bible answers that question? Yes, I would. Whoa, this is going great. Now, the faith, what you share, it's an outline, F-A-I-T-H, each letter stands for something, and so you kind of walk through it. The problem was, I didn't know it that well, because I just had that crash course training. I think I misspelled faith. I put verses where they didn't belong in the presentation. I goofed the whole thing up. It was a disaster, except what? Except the Holy Spirit just needed somebody to say something positive, because that man was ready to come to Christ that night. And he did. What's that mean? That means it's not my job to convince or convert. My job is just to share. That's all your job is. Just share your faith. Have you ever played hide and seek with a preschooler? It's different. All right, you play hide and seek with a grade school child, they hide. I mean, they try to find the hidey hole that you will never find them in. And like 3 days later, you're out there calling, Ollie, oxygen's free. They're like, oh, you ain't finding me. I'm not giving up, right? But when they're preschooler, it's a little bit different, isn't it? With a preschooler, you count to 10 or 20 or whatever, and you turn around, and it's like they're hiding like this. Right? They're just there. Like they're behind something, but not hidden behind it. Why? Because they want to get found. They want you to find them. Folks, the longer I live, the stronger the conviction is, there are a lot of people who are like spiritual preschoolers. They're just waiting for somebody to find them. They're just right there. And they're like, I'm over here. And we're so busy worried about what to say or what not to say or how we might blow it or not blow it that we don't even turn around. Folks, we need to turn around. Let's draw this to closure, right? Let's make some application. Who's your one? That's the question I want you to answer before we leave today. Who's your one? Not 10. Who's your one? Who's the one person you believe God would like you to share your relationship with Jesus with before 2021 comes to closure? I'm going to give you a good 10-month running head start, at least 9.5, okay? Who's that one person that God would lay on your heart that you would begin to do everything under His leadership to share your faith in Christ with this year? Maybe it's a family member. When I think about my one, I think about three, okay? Because I have three sons-in-laws that need to come to faith in Christ. And so those are the ones I've recommitted again. Who's your one? Maybe it's a family member. Maybe it's a friend. You know, somebody that you've had a long relationship with, and you just have a burden that they come to know Christ like you know Christ. Or maybe it's a neighbor. Like you're in this neighborhood and you know your neighbors. Or maybe you don't even know your neighbors. Can I invite you to write this website down? It's blesseveryhome.com. Just like it sounds. All one word now. Blesseveryhome.com. If you go to that website, you plug in your address. They will give you your 100 closest neighbors. And then what they'll do is they'll send you 5 a day to pray for by email. So you pray for them, you check it off, and 5 more come tomorrow. And then 5 more. What's really cool about this website, though, is you can go back in there, and you can go back in and you can begin to keep track of your interaction with those neighbors. And it kind of forces you to get to know your neighbors, which I know is a strange thing in this culture. But folks, hear me. You have a lot of neighbors. I have a lot of neighbors who don't know Jesus. And the least we can do is be praying for them. Maybe it's a co-worker, a fellow student. Maybe it's the parent of one of your children's friends. Hear me, you better be very concerned about the spiritual condition of your children's friends' parents. They have great influence on your child. That parent does. Who is it? Who's your one? Number one, commit to pray for them. Don't make this an exercise of, I'll get around to it. I really want you to name this person today. Remember, all good evangelism begins with prayer. Pray for opportunities to what? To develop and deepen the relationship. Philip and Nathaniel evidently had a very deep relationship where Philip could blow off the skepticism of Nathaniel with a very simple, just come check it out. And Nathaniel did. Okay, I'll go. I'll check it out. Pray to naturally share your faith. Opportunity simply just to, in the course of a conversation. Again, people like to talk. And there's a very natural way simply to say, you know what? That's a very great question. Here's how God's been working that out in my life. And just have the conversation, right? And then pray for the Holy Spirit to convict, convince, and convert. Pray the Holy Spirit, that's His job. Convict people of sin, convict them of righteousness, convict them of judgment to come, convict, convince them of the truth of the gospel, and then to convert, that's His job. Ours is just to share, but pray He does that in their lives. And then finally, have a plan. What's your plan to share, right? You have two stories to tell. You have your story to tell, and you have God's story to tell. Your story is very easy, right? Your story, again, is what? My life before Christ, how I came to know Christ, and then what's He doing in my life right now? What's His story? Let me give you a real simple way to share the gospel. The very first way I learned. When this guy led me to Christ, when David led me to Christ, what he did is he gave me my very first Bible. It wasn't the very first one, the very first one I ever used. And it was a soul winner's New Testament. Because Isaac, he had a crazy expectation. He expected that because he led me to Christ, I would lead others to Christ. How crazy is that? That was his expectation. That should be our expectation, shouldn't it? And the soul winner's New Testament, it was a good old King James Bible. And inside of it, it helped me. On the flap of that Bible, on the very inside, I wrote down one verse of Scripture. It was Romans 3:23. And what page number it was on. Because I didn't know how to find all the books of the Bible. Ever been there? You were so new to Jesus, you didn't even know what the big letters, big numbers were compared to little numbers. Had no idea what the difference was, right? or where the books were. I wrote down the page. Romans 3:23 is on page whatever. And I could share with somebody Romans 3:23, right? And then I shared, and I wrote down 6:23. I went to 6:23. For the wages of sin is death. Gives you God's eternal life. And then 5:8. And then 10:9 and 10 and 10:13. Folks, that's how simple it is. And some of you are looking at me like you already know this. If we already know it, why are we not sharing it? It is a trans. You want to change your community? You want to change Santa Fe? Begin to talk about Jesus. I know there are some folks you're going to, you know, they're already predisposed to kind of get angry at you. All right. That conversation ends very quickly. But I promise you, there are a lot of folks like a preschooler, and they're just waiting to get found. Waiting for somebody to share with them that God loves them. On that little blue communication card the pastor mentioned a while ago, write down your one. Write down your one. I mean, turn that card in, whether you've been a member here for 25 years, you're just here the first time, whatever it is, turn that card in with your one on your way out today. So the staff of this church can pray with you about your one. They're not gonna call you and say, hey, have you shared? It's like July 1st. Have you shared yet? Come on, get busy. They're not going to do that. But they're going to pray with you for that one. Now, here's the last thing. You may be somebody's one today. Maybe your role isn't Philip's role today. Maybe your role is Nathaniel. Whether you're here or online. And your need today is to acknowledge, yes, I need a Savior. I've done a lot of things I should have done. There's a lot of things I should have done that I haven't. The Bible calls all that sin, rebellion. And I know if I stand before a holy God right now today, it's not going to turn out well for me. And I need a Savior. And I believe that Jesus Christ died for my sin and rose from the grave to prove that that death paid the penalty of my sin for all of eternity, and that by coming to Him, repenting of my sin, turning away from my sin, and embracing Jesus fully today, I can have everything that God desires me to have, everything He created me to be, I can become by giving my life to Christ today. If that's you, can I invite you to come to Jesus today? I'm going to pray for us. Pastor Reed's going to come and lead us in the invitation. Let me pray for us. Our Lord Jesus, You have a desire that all come to relationship with You. Peter writes that You're not willing that any should perish, but that all come to repentance. God, I pray that You would not leave anybody either present or watching untouched. That all those who have not yet committed their lives to Christ would do so. But then, God, all who have would make a commitment just for one. Maybe, God, they're going to make a whole long list. But focus on the one with an intentionality by the leadership of Your Spirit to double the size of the kingdom that's represented by First Baptist Church Santa Fe by the end of 2021 by sharing our faith in Christ with at least one. God, I pray for a greater harvest. But it all begins by a commitment to that one. So, Father, as we lift those names up to You in prayer, I'm thinking of mine. These folks are thinking of theirs. your spirit having the freedom and the capability of knowing all those names, would you please, as we lift them up to you, work in their lives in such a way that you would convince, convict, and convert, that they might be followers of Christ also, sharers of an eternal inheritance. I thank you for what you're going to do. Ask it in Jesus' name. And all the people said, amen. Pastor.
Thank you, Brother Steve. Powerful message, wasn't it? We love you and appreciate that. We've come to the time in our service where we make our decisions for Christ. I want to talk to the Nathaniels that are here or watching us that you haven't met the Messiah yet. You've not come to know him. I just want to tell you that Jesus came to this world to love you, to save you from your sin, to give you a life-giving relationship with God. And if you haven't come to know Christ yet, I pray that you would do that today. You can do that by just simply offering God a prayer, praying that you know you're a sinner, you know you need forgiveness, and you want the forgiveness that Christ is offering. Pray that to the Lord. He will hear you. He will save you. You can do that as we sing in just a moment. I want to talk also to the Philips amongst us, that Philip is the one who brought Nathanael to Jesus. Who is your one? You can write that during this song. It's time for us to make a decision. Who is God calling you to share your faith with? Remember, this is for all of us. It's not for the super Christians. It's for every Christian, that we would be willing to share the love of Jesus with those around us. During this song, as we're singing, you can write that name down on the blue card, or maybe you want to put it on the yellow card and turn one of those into us. John's going to lead us in a song. How will you respond to Christ today? Let's respond together.
Let's stand together, church. Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior.
Forever, Father. church. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen.
Farmington is home. This place actually used to be called Totaw, which is Navajo for three rivers, because there are three rivers that meet here in Farmington. You have Native American cultures, you have Hispanic cultures, you have white culture, and all of them are blending together. Growing up Navajo and Hispanic, I mean, these are my people. So it was always going to be, when I finished up my college and seminary education, to come back home and to do gospel work here. This is a forgotten area. It's a neglected area. The Navajos are forgotten people. And so there are a lot of problems here, a lot of drug abuse, a lot of alcohol abuse. And you combine that with poor education, high illiteracy, broken homes, a lot of poverty. It really creates this perfect storm. So I got hired on at a high school here. Working in the schools has really given me a unique opportunity to share the gospel with a variety of students as they come into my office. They know that there's someone at the school who cares about them, who they trust, who they can go and talk to. And what that has done is, with our youth group, it's predominantly these students coming from that context that want to know more, and they're hungering for more. There has to be churches for these people. So when people give, it enables us to do ministry effectively. The Navajo people are just like any other people. They're a people who have a proud, rich history, but they're a people who need Jesus Christ. So we're here to spread the gospel, to give the good news to a forgotten people in a forgotten place.
We gotta wait 5 seconds. There we go. All right. The Annie Armstrong Easter Offering helps the North American Mission Board in funding church planting and churches who are dying in need of new life through revitalization. You just saw the video of a local church planter who's in Farmington, New Mexico, and so doing the ministry of proclaiming Jesus. So our church goal is to help raise $7,500 to help support Christ's kingdom advancing in North America. As of today, we have received almost half of our goal. So 100% of your gifts support these church planters and missionaries throughout North America. So thank you so much, church, for praying and for giving. The yellow prayer card, as Pastor Reed had mentioned earlier, as a church, we want to be praying for our family, our friends, our neighbors, those who do not know Jesus as their greatest treasure and only hope for eternal life. So we're asking everyone to fill those out so that you can be praying individually, but also so that we can corporately gather and pray together. And we do this on Wednesday nights at our prayer gathering for all church. And so if you haven't got the email invite, call the church office. We'll get that to you. And so this Wednesday, Rick and Alice Wominko will be sharing their testimony. I'd love for you to join us and hear that. Easter is quickly coming, all right? And so on April the 2nd, we're having a Good Friday a service, but before that, we're having a drive-through communion for those who are at home from 5:30 to 6, so drive-through communion here. And then our Good Friday service will begin at 6:30. We're planning to have two services on Easter Sunday, one at 9 and then the second at 11 a.m. We'll sanitize everything and make sure everything's clean and ready to go for the second service. And in between, we're also planning to have something for families and kids during that middle time. And so we're looking forward to that. The last couple things I have for us this morning is that the children's ministry team is seeking volunteers. So if you're coming to FBC and you want to know how you get plugged in or how you can serve the church, this may be the place for you. We are seeking individuals to help love on the precious kiddos of our church. And I just came back in from teaching with the kids, and they are hungry to know God's word and so much knowledge of God's word already. And so we need people to do that. And we'll help you make it easy for you. We'll train you. And it's just be part of what God is doing in the little hearts of our church. And as a reminder, if you're looking for community, one of the best ways to find that in our church is through a connection group. And so we have several that meet online via Zoom. We also one that meets on hybrid. And so the last seven words of Christ is one that's starting soon. And so if you have any questions, you can contact Pastor John to get you connected. So please, church, will you stand up as we close out in our benediction?
Also, new members class, we have our third. We're almost done. Third class today at 1. Grab a bite to eat, and we'll see you back at 1 o'clock down in the gym or on Zoom. Let's pray as we finish. Now unto him who is able to do exceedingly and abundantly beyond all we could ask or imagine, to him be glory now in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. It's in the name of Christ we pray and ask that you would be a witness in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a great week. God bless you.